I'm really delighted to be here today at PyCon, in a room full of people, packed with people. I guess the interest is strong on this library, Polars, that it's quite a new library in the data frame world in Python. Actually, not really brand new, because it's been developed for the last 3 years, but it's got really a lot of traction in the last few months. So everyone is talking about Polars, and I guess you're interested in understanding a little bit more about it. We can see Polars as a bit of an alternative to Pandas, and I will focus on an overview of the library, a bit of a comparison between different data frame libraries, and the performance side of Polars, that is one of the key features. At the end of the day, I will try to explain this graph, the reason behind this graph. This is taken from starhistory.com. That's a pretty nifty website where you can compare the number of stars that are given to projects on GitHub over time. And these are 10 projects related to the data world. You can see two heavyweights in blue and pink that are Pandas and Spark that have been developed for 10 years, or in case of Pandas, 15 years. And on the other end, you can see many alternative projects. And Polars is really standing out. It's skyrocketing. It received a lot of attention, and you can see it in red. So you can see the huge spike in the approval, in the love shown by Pythonistas to Polars. So I will try to explain if it is just hype or there is a real reason behind this. And it's the second. It's a quick spoiler. A few words about myself. My name is Alberto Danese. I'm the head of data science at Nexi. Nexi is the leading Italian and European company in digital payments. So I work with millions of transactions every day, from credit cards, from point of sales, payment gateways online. So this is my world, let's say. I'm a computer engineer. I've been working in data for a long time. And I do love data at 360 degrees, let's say. From the machine learning side, I'm a competition grandmaster on Kaggle, for instance. To also spreading the word about data. I published this book, Data Culture, that's a bit of a bridge between us, let's say data guys and girls, and stakeholders that usually don't have such a great understanding of our world, let's say. And I write also on Substack. This is allaboutdata.substack.com. So I do like to deal with data in the broader sense that I'm capable of. So back to the main topic of this presentation. I think that working with the data in Python used to be quite an easy choice till a few years ago, because there was just one variable that we had to take in consideration. That is the size of the data. For small data, we would just go and use Pandas. I think most of us are starting using Python for data science analysis, doing import Pandas SPD, let's say. And for larger data that doesn't fit in the machine memory, we would just use some kind of distributed framework, like for instance Spark, or PySpark in particular. And so the choice was easy, and this was very beneficial to the community of Pythonistas who do data science, data analysis, engineering. Because in this duality there have been two winners, let's say. The first one was Pandas, that has become a standard. It's the de facto standard when it comes to dealing with data in Python. And it really created a huge ecosystem, because many projects are built on top of Pandas. Many projects expect a Pandas data frame as an input, many machine learning libraries, for instance. And so it has all the advantages of being a standard. It has grown a huge community, thousands of contributors, to the code base, but also documentation, tutorial, stuff like that. And another very important part, at least also from an enterprise use of Pandas, is a relatively stable API. So you don't get many breaking changes every day. So you can rely on it, let's say. On the other end, working with larger data, Spark, it's not simply a data frame library. It's much more. It's a distributed computational framework. And it gave us the opportunity to scale over a cluster of machines when we have huge volumes, let's say. So it gave us the opportunity to do horizontal scaling, that is adding another machine to scale the workloads. And it has also a nice ecosystem when it comes to dealing with data. For instance, there was this project that used to be called Koalas, that was Pandas API on top of Spark Cluster, that actually has been integrated in the PySpark code base since Spark 3.2. So it's been very nice, very beneficial for us, I think. But there are also not so great aspects, from my perspective at least. When you work with Pandas, you usually get limited scaling. It's never been a library meant for speed, for pure speed. At least this is my understanding. And also the syntax, I define it questionable. You may like it or not. Maybe you are used to it, but not many people love Pandas syntax. And on the other end, on the PySpark side, it's amazing. It's very complex, very complicated. And as an engineer, I'm fascinated by complexity, let's say. But as a manager, I started to appreciate simplicity as well. So more often than not, you would just avoid having to deal with this complexity if it's not really needed. Because you have someone, either you manage a Spark cluster yourself, but it's unlikely, or you need to rely on someone else to manage it for you. So you would just like to avoid it in many cases. And in my experience at work, I realized that most of the time I'm somehow in the middle of the two. So the data is not small enough to be dealt with Pandas easily, but it's not even huge to require a Spark cluster. We are, let's say, in the middle, too big for Pandas and too small for Spark. And as a side note, when we are talking of a single machine nowadays, you can get for quite cheap huge instances, huge single machines on the cloud. You can get 700 gigabytes of RAM for a few dollars an hour. So let's keep in mind that even single machines can be very, very powerful. And so this was, in my opinion, the reason why many, many libraries in the data frame world started to appear in the last few years. Here is a very quick map. I will rush through a few of them to give you an understanding. But again, it's a map, and you know, educated people say that map is not the territory. So I would just give you some hints. I don't want to be precise on each of them because I don't have the time. But it's, the Python ecosystem on data has really grown a lot. You get many choices, many alternatives. And I will focus on Polars, but first let me give you some ideas on the other one as well. So let me start with Ray and Ask. My simple understanding of Ray and Ask is that they are more or less in the same field of Spark, so distributed computational framework that allow you to leverage a cluster of machines. So they do have data capabilities, data handling capabilities, but they are not alternatives to Pandas, not direct alternatives. They are in the data in the distributed data frame world. They're very nice projects, a lot of development on both of them, actually. Another two alternatives are Modin and VAEX. Modin used to be called Pandas on Ray, if I'm not mistaken, in the early days. And actually, it's meant to be a drop-in replacement for Pandas. So you do import modin.pandas.spd instead of doing import pandas.spd. So drop-in replacement, providing parallelism to Pandas, basically. It has got some success, but never really managed to achieve huge success and huge diffusion. And the same applies to VAEX as well. VAEX is a memory mapping alternative, so you can map data on the disk in terabytes of data without loading it in memory. But I think it's not actually developed. Last time I checked, it was not developed for the last few months. Other alternatives are DataTable and QDF. Both amazing projects from my perspective. DataTable used to be the fastest library around. And also the author of Polars mentioned this fact. 6 or 7 years ago, DataTable was way faster than everything else, but it was an R library. Then there was the port into Python by the H2O.ai guys, but it's never been so fast in Python when compared to the R version for some reasons. Still, it's a very, very nice project. Never took off, never managed to achieve huge diffusion on the community of data scientists and data analysts in Python. And QDF in RAPIDS is a solution similar to Pandas, but on top of NVIDIA GPUs. So you tie yourself to an hardware vendor, For simple data analysis, it's not something that I particularly love. Many people love NVIDIA, some other don't, like Linus Torvalds, to mention someone. Still, it's a nice library, very fast, but also your data has to fit in the GPU RAM. So usually the GPU RAM is not abundant. So it has quite a limitation. And the last two before jumping into Polars are DuckDB and Fugue. These are amazing projects from my perspective. I like them a lot, even if, especially Fugue, it's in the early days. But DuckDB, you can think of it like an alternative to SQLite, but for analytical purposes. And so very fast, very oriented to OLAP workloads. It's used in many libraries. It's used in LangChain, for instance, if you try LangChain in the generative AI workspace. But it's very SQL-centric. You may like it or not. Maybe as Pythonista, not so much. But still, a super active project. And Fugue is a semantic layer, let's say, between a cluster like Spark, Dask, Ray, and a higher-level library like Polars, like Pandas. So it's in a league of its own. It's a way to translate different high-level APIs to different clusters. So it's, again, very nice alternative. But of all the eight libraries that I mentioned very quickly, none of them are really perfect alternatives to Pandas, in my opinion, for many different reasons. On the other hand, we have Polars. Polars was designed by this Dutch guy, Richie Vink, in the first wave of the pandemic, if I'm not mistaken, really beginning of 2020. So he wanted to give to the Rust community a data frame library, an advanced data frame library. He decided to build it on top of Arrow, Arrow memory format, let's say. And since the early days, it started with, let's say, a backend in Rust and APIs for Rust, but also for Python. Now it's available also for R and for many other different languages, but the beginning was Rust plus Python. And it was his personal project. As many, let's say, open source projects, it got out of hand because it's receiving a ton of love from the community, like 60,000 stars. It's a crazy number. And the guy is still the main contributor, but the number of contributors is starting to grow a lot. And I think there are two main reasons for this success, for the success of Polars. The first one is speed. And when I talk about speed, I actually refer to two different things. The first one is pure speed, the time it takes to execute a command, okay? The average response time for operations like group bys, joins, and stuff like that. But the other stuff is performance-related features, like the lazy evaluation that I will talk about in a while, and the support for larger than memory data. So the ability to work with data that doesn't fit in memory. And so this is all speed performance. I will focus on this part today. And there is also the syntax. The syntax is purely Pythonic, very intuitive, very expressive. I think anyone with a little bit of experience in Python and no experience on Polars can understand what Polars code is doing. So it's a very nice plus. So let me focus on the performance side of things. Let me say that you can find a ton of Medium posts on benchmarks, on performance of different libraries, but there was one golden standard to me till a couple years ago, and it was the H2AI DB benchmark. I don't know, some of you are for sure familiar with this benchmark. It was developed by the guys at H2O, that is the AutoML company. Maybe some of you have used their products. They did a suite of tests, of benchmarks, published on GitHub, and ran it regularly for a while, till they stopped in mid-2021. And they used to compare like Pandas, like early versions of Polars, Datatable, and stuff like that. But still, they stopped at mid-2021. Luckily, the guys at DuckDB forked their project and started comparing, benchmarking in a proper way, reproducible way, what H2O guys were doing before. And you can find in this link the new DB benchmark that it's updated at April. So some results, well, these are crazy results if you read them. The same operations on 5 gigabytes of data, group buys and joins, are 13, 16 times faster in Polars than in Pandas. And this is Pandas 2.0 with Arrow, because some people were convinced that the limitation of Pandas was the use of a NumPy backend, and to some extent it's also true, but still you can see that even comparing Pandas 2.0 with Polars, you get crazy speed up, really crazy. This is not even the latest version, because Polars now it's 0.17 something. DuckDB is very, very high performance as well. And still, you can find a comparison and check it yourself. You can find the details, queries that you are doing, the details, detailed operations. You can reproduce this data on your machines. So crazy data, really a factor of 10, one order of magnitude faster. But still, it's not just about speed, pure speed. It's also about features. I think most of you have used Pandas, and we are used to eager evaluation. So every command gets executed one after the other. And still, it's possible in Polars, and it's perfectly fine to do this. But you can also do lazy evaluation, like you would do in some other libraries, Spark, for instance, other environments. Lazy evaluation means that you create a pipe of operations. None of them gets executed right away, but they get executed when you do a collect. When you do a collect, actually, let's say a query plan is done, optimization are done on the back end, and everything gets executed at that time, including reading data, for instance, because when you do Polars is imported as PL, so pl.read.csv, you read the whole CSV in memory. But when you do scan CSV, you just infer the schema, and it takes almost no time, 0 seconds, and you can work on this data without actually loading the data in memory. Everything happens when you call the collect statement. When you use lazy evaluation, you get two bonuses, let's say. The first one is optimizations. For instance, you have predicate pushdown and projection pushdown. That is, you try to filter the data as early as possible, depending on your actual operation, and you try to read only the actual columns that are needed. So if you have a CSV with 100 columns, but you actually operate on 5 of them, in the eager mode, you read all the CSV. In the lazy mode, only the 5 columns are actually read. And then you get all sorts of optimization in joins, group buys, and stuff like that. And you also get the support for larger than memory data sets. This is very, very important in many use cases. Because I think most of you in Pandas tried to read data in chunks. So you read 1 million rows operation, 1 million rows operation, and then you merge. You do a kind of map reduce manually, okay? In Polars, you do this with collect streaming equal true, and so Polars takes care of all of this for you, so you don't have to hard code stuff. And the thing is that when you do collect streaming equal true, the result has to fit in memory, okay? So the final group by or whatever you're doing has to fit in memory, unless you use the sync. You can use the sync and you can write the result directly to a Parquet file on disk. So the crazy thing is that it's much, much faster than Pandas. You can read larger than memory data, and you can also possibly produce larger than memory outputs. It goes at the expense of performance because you're relying on your disk, but it's something that you can do, and you cannot do on Pandas, for instance. There is a ton of documentation, by the way, that you can check if you like. So let me go to a very important point. How do we start using Polars in production? You can start using Polar in production maybe when you have a large code base in Pandas and a slow function. This is how it started, how we started using Polars in some project of ours. The thing is that you can do something in Pandas. You at some point you do 2 Polars, you convert it to a Polars data frame, or actually maybe it's the syntax is different, but anyway, you create a Polars data frame. You do fast operations in Polars, and then you go back to Pandas. This used to require some time because you had to convert formats. okay, from the back end of Pandas to the one in Polars. But now with Pandas 2.0, Pandas can have an Arrow backend the same way as Polars. So the operation has become a zero copy operation, very fast, immediate operation. You can start working like this. So let me run a little bit because I have a lot of things to say and not so much time. The proper benchmark is the DuckDB guys benchmark. Go there if you want actual performance benchmarks. But I wanted to try myself. So I downloaded a 20 gigabytes CSV from Kaggle. It's taken from GitHub pull requests. And I tried to do simple operations like group bys, operation on dates, creating a list of unique values over groups, nothing particularly fancy, and then collect the results. I did this on my old PC, desktop PC from 2016, but with 32 gigabytes of RAM. So here are the results. I compared Polars in lazy evaluation mode, Polars in eager mode, Pandas with Arrow backend, and Pandas with NumPy backend, traditional backend. Okay, you can see the result. The first two lines, the first two rows, it's the operation on the whole dataset. It's too big to fit in the RAM of my PC. You will not get the result in Pandas, and not even in Polars eager mode, but you get the result in Polars lazy mode. Super important. So you can work on your local machine. Then I tried to work on the first 10 million of rows out of 89 or 90 million of rows. You get the result in all the cases, but still, reading the CSV is still much faster in Polars than it is in Pandas. Pandas with NumPy, it's extremely slow, but Pandas with Arrow, it's faster. It has a faster CSV reader. But still, the operations are way faster in Polars. If you compare eager mode and PyArrow and Pandas with PyArrow, it's 15 times faster, more or less the same that they are getting in DuckDB benchmark. In lazy mode, actually, for some reasons, here it's a bit slower if you compare the reading the data and evaluating the operation than eager mode. But the optimization phase takes some time, and I'm working on many of the columns, so lazy mode doesn't give you many optimization in this case. But overall, it's way faster than Pandas. And if it's not enough, you have approximate functions. You, for instance, counting unique values, you can have approximate unique values if you need extreme speed. I won't spend a long time on this, but you get these opportunities. The syntax is amazing, but Luca Baggi will talk about the syntax tomorrow in the talk at 2:30 in the afternoon. So he's a great guy, very skilled. Go listen to him. Many people like the speed, but stay for the syntax of Polars. Still, just a sneak peek, it's very easy to read what this function is doing, what this operation is doing. I think most of you can understand it right away. It's a bit verbose, maybe, but very expressive, and you can do stuff much more complicated than this, actually. So what is missing from Polars? I think three things are missing from Polars. That they are all due to the fact that it's quite a new library. So it doesn't get the stability that you have with Python. The author likes to break things doesn't have the stability of the API as its main value. So for instance, Polars 0.17 broke something of 0.16, but it's something perfectly fine. Otherwise you end up like Pandas that has to keep consistency and to some extent limits your evolution. The ecosystem is not as big as the one in Pandas, not even close, and the community as well. But these things can change, in my opinion, in the first few months, years. They are due to the fact that it's a new library. Nothing strange this year. By the way, when I say that Polars have very frequent releases, the last seven releases in Polars span 20 days, while the last seven in Pandas span 7 months. So it's a completely different stuff. So let me close the presentation because I'm running late. I think that if you don't like Pandas syntax, if you want to deal with larger data, if you need more speed, they are all good reasons to start using Polars, to give it a try at least, because it's built on state-of-the-art technologies, very nice syntax, very nice performance, frequent releases. You are also starting to get the first courses. There is a nice one at camco.com that it's free. There are others, other paid courses. I think it's good to start working with it. Also, Pandas 2.0 has brought some developments, but it's not even close to the speed that you get with Polars. So just give Polars a try, I think. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Alberto. So there are a few questions. It's very interesting topics. You make out of great points in using Polars, but you know that there is quite a lot of aficionado for Pandas. And a question was about how do you feel we became, strong enough, perhaps stable enough, also well known enough to be in production, in environments, in company, in industry, and perhaps you already have some case studies for that you can share?
We do have some running code with Polars, so it can be used in production. I think, handle with care. There is also, Pandas is the reason why we're all using Python for data science and data analysis. But still, you can try on a subset of your projects, start working with it, maybe a slow function. It all started with a slow function for me, and this is a good way to start. Then if you take a look at this, at the first slide, let me go back. Star History is super nice. You can also align the timeline the other way around, so shift it to the left, and you can see that the derivative, the gradient of Polars, it's higher than everything else. So I think it has all it takes to maybe to be the new Pandas in the future. I don't know.
Great, that's an argument I can bring to the head manager. So let's check this out with a feature that resembles this case. Particular question about is there an efficient graph-based database, something like SparkQL, which is used for RDF graph?
So sorry, I couldn't get it. If there are features from the SQL database, no.
If you want directly, yes. If you want to give some clarification of the question, please raise your hand. I think it was more based on connection with database, something.
Yeah, you can,
think about it.
There is a lot of development going on. It all started with the possibility to read CSV. Now you can read, delta tables. You can read many components. You get connectors in AWS to connect to AWS databases. I'm not particularly familiar with GraphDBs to this extent. So I think the community develops at a crazy speed. There are many pull requests, many development going on. Maybe at the moment there is not a straight alternative, but it can come in the future.
Is it possible, based on this, to propose a feature for Polars?
Yeah, the community is very active, super active. 6,000 commits in 3 years, it's a lot. And I've been using Polars a bit for more than 1 year, and let me see if I can immediately get this one. Now if you check on GitHub, 70% of the commits are done by Richie Vink. It's quite a lot, but it was the same with Wes McKinney in Pandas in the early days. Now this percentage is getting lower and lower. A few months ago it was 80%, I double checked. So the community is growing, yeah.
Question about does Polars compare to Pandas to perform sort operations?
Oh, there are. Used? I use them. I guess they are not in the official benchmarks in DuckDB's benchmarks, but these kind of operations are super quick in Polars. So sort operation, regular DB operations, so also operations over partitions that maybe you're used to in SQL or in Pandas or wherever, are all supported with Polars and very speedy, very, very quick.
Great, thank you. Okay. And one last question, maybe one more, just arrived. So you showed different moments of the talk, this comparison between Pandas, also PySpark, is a little bit in the middle. Mm-hmm. Do you have an idea of other operation that at the moment are not covered, for example, inequality joins, or if you know something about developed in that sense?
I've never, in the actual use, I've never found a function in pandas that I couldn't translate in polars. Then there are some notes also by the author, by Richie Vink, where, you know, effective polars is one thing, and then doing stuff with lambdas within polars also cut some of the performance advantage of polars. But still, I've never, you know, had the need to be stuck with pandas. Let's put it this way.
Thank you. Well, so one last question, very quick. Will it support red pickle files?
We need to.
We will. It will support pickle files.
I think it already does, but I'm not an expert on the topic.
Okay. So, what's the best connection to the community in order to perhaps ask more?
To ask more on
GitHub.
GitHub, there is a crazy community that pulls out new releases every few days. So,
great,
sure, that's the right way to do.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Roberto.